Hi guys, it's Toddy here from Rekombu, and in front of me I'm holding the newly unveiled Motorola Moto Z2 Play in my left hand, and in my right I have the Samsung Galaxy S8, so obviously Samsung's 2017 flagship, and we're putting it up against a premium mid-ranger in the Z2 Play, so it's a kind of an odd comparison, but this phone has a lot to offer, and especially considering there's quite a notable price difference, you get quite a lot for your money, so I just wanted to take you through the similarities and the differences between these two phones, so you know exactly what you're getting for your cash. And you might be surprised by what the Motorola brings to the table. So let's start with the design. Obviously both phones are, they're pretty slick looking handsets in their own right, but they are distinctly different design approaches. We've already covered the Samsung Galaxy S8 and the S8 Plus by extension in great detail already, but it's arguably one of the most striking looking handsets of the year so far. And that's predominantly thanks to this display, which is an 18.5:9 aspect ratio display. So it's narrower and taller than your traditional 16:9 display, as is on its predecessors and as is on the Moto Z2 Play as well. So that is something to consider because it does give you this almost completely bezel-less look. They call it the infinity display. And it's a stunning panel. It's a WQHD Plus panel, so I believe it's 2960x1440 rather than 2560 as on the S7 and S7 Edge. And obviously it goes right down to the bottom here, and the corners are rounded. And because the edges are curved as well, the look means it's almost bezel-less. It basically means that the actual physical kind of frame of the phone almost melts away in your hands, so you're just holding the screen. So it is a really great looking device, and that's obviously never been in contention since the phone was unveiled. Also on the front of the S8, we also have, there's a front facing camera, an 8 megapixel front facing camera with an f1.7 aperture, so it's one of the widest apertures on a front facing camera in the market, and it's an up res from its predecessor again. And also next we have an IR sensor, because this also has iris scanning technology, so you can actually unlock the phone through iris scanning. One of the design changes that the company did have to make in making this for kind of full infinity display was they moved the fingerprint sensor that used to be in the home button on traditional Samsung phones. So now you have this tactile haptic feedback home button experience on the screen here, but the fingerprint sensor is actually now moved around the back. It's arguably less convenient. It's quite a reach as well for your finger, but it is very fast, and you can include gestures there. You can swipe down to pull down the notifications tab and things like that. So it does have some added value being on the back, but it's still a little bit more awkward than it was with previous versions of the phone. But I'll get to the rest of the design in just a second. With the Moto Z2 Play, we have a much more tried and tested form factor, like we've seen from previous Z phones in the Moto range, and also a whole host of other flagships that are now kind of fitting this recipe, this kind of form factor. So we have a 5.5 inch display versus a 5.8 inch on the Samsung, but a 16:9 aspect ratio, so it's wider and squatter, and it's also a full HD panel. Both phones use Super AMOLED technology, so you both offer really excellent brightness, really excellent colors, really nice vibrant colors, and really nice contrast as well, really excellent blacks, whichever phone you pick. Arguably, the Samsung's panel does have a bit more brightness drop-off at more extreme angles, which you might be able to see there, especially on the Google Bar. You can see it kind of graying out as I tilt the phone. That's not going to be a deal-breaker for most people, but it's something to consider. Obviously, you are getting one of the most interesting screens in the market with the S8 and the S8 Plus, which is a slightly larger display. I believe it's a 6.1-inch panel. I'll just check my cheat sheet because 6.2 inches, excuse me, on the S8 Plus. But either way, the form factor is still really narrow. On the Moto Z2 Play, it's a full HD Super AMOLED panel, so a lower resolution, but it still is a really nice looking screen. Iconography and text is still really, really sharp. And it's, no real complaints about the display, but just in comparison to the Samsung, it just that looks that little bit more special than the Moto, what the Moto is offering. Again, you have on-screen buttons like you do on the Samsung phone, but the fingerprint sensor is beneath those, and you can actually reprogram that in the settings, if I'm not mistaken, to behave like a single one-button operation of these three functions here. So you do have that flexibility with the interface if you want to make more of the UI visible with less of the on-screen buttons, obviously. Up top as well, we have a slightly lower resolution camera here. We have a 5 megapixel front facer, still with large pixels. I believe they're 1.4 micron pixels. And interestingly, a dual tone front facing LED flash. So the Samsung uses the screen as a flash, which gives you a nice soft light. But the front facing flash on the Moto is actually very, very good because it is dual tone. obviously, but it is a point light, so it does give you a harder image. So it depends whether you want those kind of more soft, natural looking, or you want more striking selfies. And it obviously depends on the environments you're shooting as well, but you will get higher resolution selfies out of the Samsungs over the Moto Z2 Play. Elsewhere on the body, the Moto Z2 Play is a metal bodied phone, so it's a really nice premium build. It looks great and it feels great in the hand. It's kind of slab sided on the back here, but I can talk about that, why that is, in a second. It's got this textured power button here, and thickness wise it's just under 6mm thick, but that does exclude the camera bump here, obviously. Something Samsung was looking to do, the S7 and S7 Edge had almost achieved that, but this phone is closer to 8mm thick, but it has zero camera bump, so they've completely flattened that down flush. There's a slight lip under your finger, but it's not really perceptible in profile, maybe a tiny bit there. So you don't get a camera bump. If you don't like the protrusion of that in your pocket or in your bag, then actually the Samsung obviously has that kind of slimmer overall feel, despite being a thicker device in the hand. The Samsung is also heavier by about 10 grams. It's 155 versus 145, so this is a really nice lightweight phone, considering its 5.5 inch screen size. And also there's something down the bottom here, which is the Moto Mods connector, which is kind of a big differentiator for the Moto Z family, the Z Force, Z Play, and the Z2 Play now as well. And what that actually allows you to do is snap on a whole host of accessories. So for instance, this is the JBL Soundboost 2, which is a new speaker with an integrated battery, but you can snap that on, then you get much beefier sound out of the speaker. It's got integrated kickstand, but you can just as easily swap this out for Samsung. Motorola's already got a projector. They've got a camera, Hasselblad camera mod with an optical zoom. They have these style shells, which just snap on there. They've also got a gamepad coming out as well. But these obviously add to the cost, because none of them, I don't believe, come bundled. You might get a style shell depending on where you buy the phone, but for the most part, you don't get that with the out of the box. You don't get any kind of additional accessories. They all cost more on top of that, and some of them can be quite expensive. I think the projector is around £270 or something like that, so you do want to bear that in mind if you do want to invest in this because of the Moto Mods ecosystem. It's very cool and very, very versatile. It makes this phone far more versatile in some ways than even the likes of the S8 and the S8 Plus, but it will ramp the cost up pretty quickly. And that camera bump also is something to consider when you're buying this phone. It's a lighter, thinner phone, but it does have that camera bump, so it's not as elegant, potentially, in some areas, depending on what you're looking for. Both phones also, I should mention, retain a headphone jack, and they both feature, if the camera can focus, Type-C USB down the bottom. So both phones have that convenience of Type-C USB. There's a single downward-facing speaker on the Samsung, but you do actually get a front-facing output from the Moto, and obviously you can even augment that with the likes of the Soundboost speaker mods to really up the audio chops of this phone over the Samsung phones. Something also Motorola doesn't really make a big deal about, but they do coat their phones in hydrophobic treatment, so the components are protected against water ingress, but they don't ever put really an IP rating on it. So the Z2 Play doesn't have any formal IP rating for dust and water resistance, but it can probably take a shower, a light shower. You can use it in the rain without worry, whereas the Samsung Galaxy S8 and S8 Plus both feature IP68 certification, which I believe is a meter and a half of fresh water for up to 30 minutes, which is quite impressive. Especially always appreciated on a flagship phone, but it means this phone can be fully submerged in fresh water and you don't really have to worry too much about it. So that's arguably a point in the favour of the S8 and the S8 Plus's design work there. Also not forgetting the fact that these things just look beautiful, not only because of that screen, but that kind of continuous form all the way around. If you get the different colours, this is the black option, but if you get the orchid grey, for example, the frame on this is actually metal, like bare metal or silver finish. But the glass on the back is a fingerprint magnet, as you can see here. And also, this phone does also attract scratches seemingly more readily than the Moto Z2 Play does, especially on the back here. There's a few nicks and bumps there. If you polish it up, you can see them. So it's advisable to put a case on either phone, but especially on the Samsung phones because of their kind of shiny, glossy finish and their glass and their material choices, basically. That said, both still very hardy devices. So I've touched on the screen technology at play. Another thing to mention here is you might have just seen the Galaxy S8, as its predecessor, features this always-on functionality. And with the S8, it's a little bit more interesting because it's got color. So you can get, you know, notifications and stuff. You can see, though, as I'm vibrating the table, the Moto is responding, but usually it's good if you just leave it. It's not always on, but what the Z2 Play can do is that when it's nudged or if there's enough of a knock, it won't do it now, obviously. It's hard to kind of get it to show it off on command. There we go. But you can see it will light up and give you a brief kind of overview of any missed notifications, your battery, signal, etc., the date and time. So both have that kind of added convenience from their displays, which is really appreciated. Motorola also add in a few gestures. They call them, I think, Moto Actions. I don't know if any are enabled right now, but the app here kind of shows them off. So you can do things like double twist to quick launch the camera. You can also, the Moto display is what I was just talking about. Voice is similarly to Google. You can, you know, use the OK Google command to wake the phone. But this also has a karate chop action to turn on the flashlight and things like that. So there are some nice kind of accelerometer based actions in here, quick shortcuts that you don't get necessarily on the Samsung. You can of course quick launch the camera from this, from the lock screen, or using the double tap on the hardware keys, but it doesn't quite have quite the same versatility and range of quick launch features that the Motorola possesses. Whilst we're looking at the Moto, the user experience we're actually looking at here is a really nice clean take on Android 7.11 Nougat. So it's the latest build of Nougat readily available in the market. And Motorola has famously kept things simple every time they do their own tweaked version of Android. It's almost stock. The launcher, as you can see, if you've seen the Google Pixel or Pixel XL, feels very reminiscent of that, with a quick swipe up to the App Store. And aside from obvious additional apps like the Moto Mods app and the Moto Actions app, everything else is almost stock. So that is a really appreciated aspect of the phone, especially for a newcomer, or if you just like a clean, snappy take on Android, then the Android experience offered up by the Z2 Play is a really strong offering in that regard. Now on the Samsung's front, Samsung has rather dramatically redesigned its interface design, but it's a really nice take on Android 7.0. So it's not quite 7.11 yet, but it will almost certainly get an update to 7.11 down the line. It does have a whole host of doubled up apps, things like its own web browser running atop or alongside Chrome. But you can see there's this very, very simple App Store, is a swipe up or a swipe down, it doesn't matter. And you can get to it that way, which is really nice. So it's really easy to navigate. There's a universal search bar in there as well. So it's arguably one of the simplest and cleanest takes on TouchWiz that we've seen ever from Samsung. So they've made great strides. It's also got this very heavy-handed, I would say, art style, these new icons and stuff, designed to look cool and cutting edge, but I think that will date quite quickly. So from an aesthetic standpoint, I personally don't like that, but you can customize the look and feel of this. I think there's a theme store in there from Samsung, which we've seen on other Samsung phones. So you do have that functionality if you want to customize the look and feel of the S8 and the S8 Plus, which you don't really get with the Moto, which is much closer, as I said, to stock Android. Another big component of Samsung's user experience with the S8 and the S8 Plus is Bixby. So it's a mix of news and pertinent information to you and your location, based on calendar, based on weather, based on steps. It collates all of that information, and they've just launched the voice element of this in the US, and it will eventually come to the UK. But you'll be able to carry out more advanced voice actions than what Google Now and OK Google voice commands allow. Basically, Samsung pictures it as anything you can do with touch on the S8 and the S8 Plus, you'll be able to do with voice using Bixby voice. The other thing is that it's accessible via a dedicated hardware key, so even from sleep you can get Bixby up and running. That used to be customizable, but Samsung locked that functionality down, which is a real shame. But the Bixby Assistant, even though it doesn't get a lot of love, it has potential, and provided they keep working on it, it could actually be a genuinely useful alternative to the Google Assistant, which right now I'd say is the best option on any Android device if you're looking for assistant sort of functionality in that regard. Now, whilst design is obviously a big difference between these two devices, another thing really worth mentioning here is performance. The Samsung Galaxy S8 is a flagship. It's a 2017 flagship as well, so it's one of the most powerful handsets on the market. And that in Europe is because it's powered by a Samsung Exynos 8895 processor and 4 GB of RAM. So loads of RAM and a comparable to Qualcomm Snapdragon 835 chipset in terms of performance, which is the chip it actually uses in the States and a few other markets as well. So you're getting a flagship class experience through and through this phone. It benchmarks extremely well. It has no problems running anything you throw at it. The multitasking experience on this is great. The split screen experience is great as well, because you can actually run, depending on what you're running, certain apps don't like that, but you can actually run, I believe it's 14% more screen height over its predecessor, so you can actually fit more of one app on screen. So it works really well if you want to, say, play a YouTube video up in the top half and then run a messaging app down below. That is surprisingly competent and actually a really good and usable experience. With the Moto Z2 Play, what we're working with is, again, you get 4 gigabytes of RAM, but it's a Qualcomm Snapdragon 626. So it's a slight upgrade on the 65 from the Z Play from last year. But it is definitely a premium mid-range chipset, so it's not technically a flagship class processor. That said, this phone feels just as fast in everyday use as any flagship that we've tested recently. So you really won't have any real issues with performance. And again, you do have split screen multitasking because Android 7.0 is in there, so that's native. 4 gigabytes of RAM should keep this phone feeling fresh for your average 18-month contract. And also both phones match storage and expandability as well. So both come with 64 gigabytes of space internally and micro SD expandability up to, I believe it's 256 gigabytes in both cases. So for storage-wise, you're matched. Performance-wise, the 835 or the 8895 that you get in the S8 and the S8 Plus beats the 626 inside the Moto Z2 Play on paper. But in everyday use, you're going to be hard-pressed to really see a real difference. This phone can multitask. This phone can run 3D games without issue. So that also really saves you costs. If you're willing to make the jump down to the lower 626, knowing that you're not going to lose out too much on the general everyday usability of your phone, you save a lot of money if you're willing to do that, which I'll talk about price at the very end. The other thing to mention is battery. Both these phones pack equal size batteries, despite this obviously being a narrower, thinner phone, or narrower, I should say, it's technically thicker. Both phones feature 3000 milliamp hour batteries. In the case of the Moto Z2 Play, that's quoted at 30 hours of 3G usage, and it is very, very good. You get around, we've managed around almost 2 days of use per charge, which is wholly commendable. And obviously there is fast charging in there too via that USB connection with Moto's own turbo power charger tech. Samsung gets you around almost a day and a half, so you get slightly less battery longevity from the S8, and there's a slightly larger cell in the, it's a 3,500 milliamp hour cell in the S8 Plus, which again is a good for about a day and a half, maybe just a little bit over in the case of the Plus model. But either way, you get slightly less battery life over the Z2 Play. What you do, however, get is, again, you get adaptive fast charging, Samsung's equivalent fast charging tech, which is very, very good now. And you do get wireless charging built into the phone, and wireless fast charging if you have a compatible Samsung wireless charger. So you do get that, which you don't get in the native experience of the Z2 Play. I say native because actually they have now introduced I think I have one here. This looks very similar to the standard woven style shell, which I have in my right hand, but this one is slightly thicker. I don't know if you can see that there. And also the connections on the back are slightly different, but this Moto Mod, which I'll put the price on screen, which launched alongside the phone, so you can get this at the same time. This does actually add in wireless charging, so this phone can have wireless charging, but it will cost you extra. Moto also doesn't sell any wireless charging pads of its own, but it works with any Qi standard wireless charging pad. So anything you get from like IKEA to what you'd find in, I think, McDonald's or Starbucks or anything like that, or anywhere that Air Charge, which is a pretty well-respected wireless charging brand, that mod will be compatible with all of those chargers. So you do have the functionality available to you if you own a Z2 Play, you just don't have it out of the box that you do with the S8 and the S8 Plus. Now, the last thing is, of course, the cameras. So I talked about the front cameras. The rear cameras, both are actually surprisingly similar considering the standings of these two devices. So in the case of the Z2 Play, we're actually looking at a 12 megapixel camera with an f1.7 aperture, dual focus pixel technology, and a dual tone LED flash and EIS. It's really good. It could take 4K video. It shoots in HDR by default. It's quick. Low light is actually surprisingly good. Video stability is nice and smooth. For all intents and purposes, again, it feels like a flagship camera. The user experience is a little simple. It's a bit basic, but it's clean. So it's a great one if you're not if you just want to snap and go and you don't like fussing around with the settings, this is a great experience for that. It's a very easy to swipe out menu. Quick capture, you can do that quick launch action, as I mentioned earlier. 4x3 for 12 megapixel photos. You can actually change capture method as well, so you can tap anywhere on the screen if you want. And like I said, you get 60 and 4K video recording as well. So you have a host of options there. In terms of shooting modes, you've got pro, slow motion video recording, you've got panorama video and stills, and that's it. So very simple, very clean shooting experience. But the camera quality is actually really, really good. It is flagship class, I would say, or close to it. With the S8 and the S8 Plus, these guys have I would argue a superior cameras to even the likes of the Pixel and the Pixel XL. So I'd say these phones are the best cameras on the market. But on paper, they sound very similar. Again, it has a 12 megapixel rear camera with an f1.7 aperture, dual focus pixel technology. The only difference being that this one has, I believe it's OIS and EIS. So it's got hybrid image stabilization. It again shoots in HDR by default. You get 4K video recording, of course, but you do get a whole host more modes out of the box. So you get things like hyperlapse, selective focus, food shooting, and you can actually download more from Samsung's own Galaxy App Store, so you can add in more shooting modes that you can't do on the Moto at all. So in terms of shooting versatility, you'll get more out of the Samsung experience than you will out of the Motorola experience. Also, there's a few additional capture modes. The UI is designed to work one-handed really well, so this shutter button, you can actually use it, drag it up and down to become a zoom function as well. You can also have a floating shutter, which lets you move the shutter around. And there's a few other tweaks in there. Also, Bixby is integrated into the camera in what's called Bixby Vision. So what that means, if you point it at a subject, and you get various options depending on what's in frame. So it can be wine, it can be a landmark, it can be an item that you bought from a supermarket, and you'll get various options. So I can go shopping. Okay, that was a bad example, but in the right situations, it will find similar images. So here it's found toy cars. Like, that's a pretty close, like, for, like, RC car. This has greater relevance depending on the use case. Using a car on the table here isn't the best example of this technology. But Bixby Vision has got some legs to it. It has got some mileage, depending on what you're looking for. But if you're maybe exploring a new city, this is a great way to discover things about that city using Bixby Vision. You can just point it at a landmark, and it'll tell you about it. So there's arguably more going on inside the Samsung Galaxy S8 and S8 Plus, and obviously that design is killer. That camera is a little bit better. There's a few more charging capabilities, a few more software features. It's slicker and snappier, but I wouldn't say by the price difference. This phone is almost £200 more expensive than the Moto Z2 Play. The Moto Z2 Play, which is launching in August, is £379, and that's obviously before you add in any Moto Mods. The Moto Mods can range from anything from, I believe it's like £30, £15 or £30, up to £270, I think, for the InstaShare projector, somewhere around there. So you can add on a lot to this, but that does mean you get more functionality if you spent the same money on this and some Moto Mods as you do with just the phone, in the case of the S8 and the S8 Plus. So the S8, the starting price, wherever you look for it right now, SIM-free, is £689. So £310 more expensive for this phone than this phone. And there's definitely not £300 worth of difference between these two handsets. So that is definitely something to consider. If you want a premium smartphone experience, but you don't have the cash, this is a really, really competent option. Obviously, if you want the best of the best, the S8 and the S8 Plus are potentially the best options you can go for right now, but you do need that extra capital up front, or you want to enter into a pricey and long-term contract if you want to eke out the cost of this phone. But there you go. There is the Motorola Moto Z2 Play versus the Samsung Galaxy S8 and S8 Plus. If we missed anything out, or if you have any outstanding questions between these two phones, or you want to know more about either handset, we already have coverage on recombu.com and on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/recombu. Don't forget to subscribe. Drop us a line down below in the comments if you still have outstanding questions. And thanks for watching.